This episode is sponsored by Squarespace. Go to squarespace.com/microcosmos to get a free trial and 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Our master of microscopes, James, seems like a tough person to get a gift for. Like, what do you get for the person who has the entirety of the microcosmos available to him with just a glimpse through a lens? But one of his friends and frequent collaborators, Professor Genoveva Esteban, sent him a gift for his 34th birthday that seems especially difficult to top. She sent him a Ziploc bag full of white sand from the Marshall Islands. All of the samples we are looking at today come from that bag of sand, which means that they all have their origins in this archipelago that lies in the Pacific Ocean. The existence of the Marshall Islands is intimately tied to life in the oceans around them. For example, you may have heard of a place called Bikini Atoll, a name immortalized by a style of swimsuit and referenced in a popular cartoon revolving around a sponge who wears square pants. Bikini Atoll is one of 29 atolls that make up the Marshall Islands, and atolls like it are distinctive in part because they are shaped like rings, the result of a process that spans millions of years. These atolls begin as volcanoes that rise from the ocean floor to become islands and provide the means for corals to form a reef around them that's separated by a lagoon. Over time, the island sinks and erodes away, leaving behind the reef and the lagoon. Then the reef animals die and decay, and waves break them up into sand that can accumulate into an island, creating the atoll. And so, as we sift through the sample that James has received, what we're potentially observing is a spectacular example of the way that geology and biology are intertwined on our planet. Are we looking at land, or are we looking at an organism? The answer is yes, but with many mysteries and question marks, like the samples we're showing you now, which we do not know how to identify. They lie outside of the considerable expertise of James, though he did have some guesses. If any of you have more specific ideas about what we might be watching right now, we would love to hear them. James suspects these might be large eroded pieces of coral, and this shining bit of red material might be some minerals, perhaps bits of red rock that James could see in his sample. This, well, James doesn't know, but he found a couple of them in his sample, and it looks a lot like a tooth, though we do not know if it actually is one. Bikini Atoll and the Marshall Islands are well known for another reason. Between 1946 and 1958, the islands were the site of 67 nuclear explosive tests carried out by the United States. 23 of those tests took place on Bikini Atoll, and 44 were near another area called Aniwetak Atoll. Those atolls had been previously evacuated, but the tests performed on them still impacted people living in the Marshall Islands. A 2004 report by investigators from the National Cancer Institute estimated that 20 of the tests exposed populations on nearby atolls in the Marshall Islands to measurable radioactive fallout. That has led to health impacts that continued to affect people long after the nuclear tests ended. The samples that we are looking at cannot speak to the impacts the tests had on the people who call the Marshall Islands home. James's friend verified that these samples were not radioactive before sending them to him. But in the same way that the islands are an embodiment of the life that surrounds them, their sediments are a record of the way that we interact with that life. And James's samples were beautiful foraminifera, like the spiral you see at the center of the screen now. Foraminifera are amoeba-like single-celled organisms that have encased themselves in a hard shell called a test. And when they die, those shells become part of the world around them, even becoming a major component of sand in the Western and Pacific atolls. The chemistry they leave behind in those remains is a little history of the world that that organism lived in. In 1946, a study of Bikini Atoll led to the collection of different samples around the lagoon, producing around 900 sediment samples that revealed the presence of bodies and remains of various organisms, including coral, algae, mollusks, and yes, foraminifera. And scientists are still using populations of foraminifera in the area to study how humans are shaping the local environment. In 2010, scientists published a study on foraminifera in the Majuro Atoll in the Marshall Islands. They found that some of the genera they were studying declined in number as they got closer to the more densely populated islands, though other genera did not seem as affected. One possible explanation is that the species whose population densities were lower near populated islands were dealing with a surprising issue: an abundance of nutrients in the water. Now, you might expect nutrients to be good for organisms, but the challenge for these particular foraminifera is that they rely on symbiosis with algae living within them, exchanging various advantages with one another, like food. But with an abundance of nutrients in the water, the algae no longer need their amoeba hosts, making the area less welcoming for the foraminifera. That's one of the ideas, but of course, there are other potential explanations. And the bigger question is how this will shape the islands in the years to come. If organisms like the foraminifera make up so much of the island, what happens when their numbers go down? Or is there some larger pattern at work, one we cannot see from the inside? A pattern made up of small actions and even smaller creatures, and woven together over millions of years. A little gift left by time for someone else to unwrap. Thanks for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. Thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this episode. Squarespace is a powerful all-in-one platform for entrepreneurs to stand out and succeed online. Whether you're just starting out or managing a growing brand, Squarespace makes it easy to create a beautiful website, engage with your audience, and sell anything from products to content to time, all in one place, all on your terms. If you want a place to organize and share beautiful video content, you can do that on Squarespace. You can set the price for viewers to access your content, whether that's a one-time fee or a subscription or members-only content. And with flexible payment options, checkout for your customers will be seamless. Squarespace offers a robust set of analytics to monitor traffic and sales, giving you the data you need to grow your audience. Go to squarespace.com to sign up for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/microcosmos to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Thanks so much to all the people whose names are on the screen right now. They are our Patreon patrons, the people who have allowed us to make so many delightful little Journey to the Microcosmos videos. This channel is now chock full of so many amazing videos because of their support. So if you're looking for someone to thank for the existence of this channel, these are them. Thank you so much to our patrons. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's probably a subscribe button somewhere nearby.